Hello everyone and welcome to NewsClick's Daily Roundup. I'm Prashant.
I'm Probir Purkayastha and we're going to look at the top stories today.
Our top story for the day is the court verdict in the Ishrat Jahan fake encounter case. Charges against former Gujarat police officers DG Vansara and NK Amin, the main accused in the case, have been dropped by a CBI court. The CBI had charged the former police officers with conspiracy, illegal confinement, and the murder of Ishrat Jahan, which happened in 2004. Vansara and Amin had filed discharge requests in the court after the Gujarat government refused to grant permission to the CBI to prosecute them. Ishrat Jahan, who was 19 at the time of her death, and three others were killed on June 15, 2004 near Ahmedabad. The police had accused her and the others of being Lashkar-e-Taiba terrorists who were planning to assassinate Narendra Modi, the then Chief Minister of Gujarat. Enquiries in the following years concluded that the encounter was fake. However, a lot of criticism has been raised against the National Investigation Agency and others for not following up the case against the police officers. Here is a look at some of the details of this controversial case. Probably to look at this case, the National Investigation Agency, as I said, is one of the agencies which has been in the dock for not properly taking the investigation forward. And after all these years, we have these officers being acquitted. So how do you see this result?
Well, it's important to register two elements over here. That was a unanimous decision of the special investigations team set up by the Gujarat High Court, which had said this was a fake encounter, right. They were kidnapped and they were executed.
Right.
So that was what the Gujarat High Court Special Investigation Team had come to a conclusion. So I think that is one element we have to keep in mind. Mm-hmm. And this time, what has happened is not that the case was not prosecuted, mm-hmm. but the Gujarat government did not give permission,
right.
did not give them sanction. And under law, the government needs to give permission
right.
if the officers have to be prosecuted. Two issues. Which Vrinda Grover, the lawyer for Shamim Kausar, Ishrat Jahan's mother had raised, that was that A, when it said government, it should have been the central government,
mm-hmm.
because these were essentially IPS officers.
Right.
Therefore, Ministry of Home was the right body.
Mm-hmm.
But apart from that, they've also raised the issue that permission is required if the officers are doing their duty,
right.
and if a certain activity had resulted in whatever could be constituted as a crime. But in this case, this was not something they were doing as a part of their duty. That therefore, permission was not required.
Right.
Well, the judge has not accepted this, discharged the officers concerned, and we'll have to see what legal measures now can be taken.
Right. Moving on to another institution, which has faced criticism in recent times, the Election Commission on Wednesday gave a clean chit to Prime Minister Narendra Modi on his comments regarding the Pathankot and Balakot strikes. Speaking at Latur, Narendra Modi had asked first-time voters to dedicate their votes to those who died in the Pulwama attack and those who took part in the Balakot strikes. These comments led to a huge outrage, and political parties, including the CPIM and the Congress, approached the EC against these polarizing remarks. However, the EC ruled that these comments are not a violation of the Model Code of Conduct. Similarly, the EC finally punished terror-accused and BJP candidate for Bhopal, Sadhvi Pragya Singh, but with only a 3-day ban on campaigning. Ever since being nominated, Pragya Singh has made a number of polarizing and inflammatory statements. The most offensive of these was the insinuation that former ATS chief Hemant Karkare had died due to her curse. Karkare was killed in the line of duty during the 2008 Mumbai terror attacks. Pragya Singh also said that she was proud of taking part in the demolition of the Babri Masjid in 1992. In an interview, she said, "We removed a blot from the country. I feel extremely proud that God gave me this opportunity and I could do that." Despite such comments, Pragya Singh has been banned for merely 3 days. It is worth recalling that the same election commission barred former BSF Jawan Tej Bahadur Yadav from contesting the elections. Tej Bahadur was dismissed from the BSF after he released a video exposing the poor quality of food served to forces deployed in the mountainous regions. Our next story is about the Kashi Vishwanath corridor, a dream project of Prime Minister Narendra Modi. The project involves creating a path to help devotees reach the Kashi Vishwanath temple easily. However, is there a dark side to this project? The process of leveling the region has thrown into sharper focus the Gyanwapi Mosque, which the Hindu right wing has long had its eyes on. Are we seeing another Babri Masjid incident in the making? NewsClick's Antariksh talks to people from the area to find out.
अब आप इनके क्रियाकलाप को देखिएगा तो खुदे समझ में आएगा कि अगर हमको केवल यात्रियों की सुविधा के लिए व्यवस्था करनी थी तो काशी के मूल स्वरूप को उजाड़ने की क्या आवश्यकता थी? Gyanwapi परिसर आपने ले लिया, उसको व्यवस्थित कर दीजिए, 20,000 पब्लिक एक साथ उस परिसर में आ जाएगी। अब 2 लाख पर एक साथ तो आती नहीं है पब्लिक दर्शन करने कि एक साथ 2 लाख आ गए। 20,000 अगर उसके जिगजैग टाइप से बना के उसको व्यवस्थित कर दीजिए तो वो 20,000 निकलते जाएंगे, आते जाएंगे, निकलते जाएंगे। अब देखिए पूरा मैदान तैयार हो गया है, अब मस्जिद लोगों को दिखा रहे हैं।
ये हमारी मस्जिद है,
ये वाली आपकी हाँ, मस्जिद है।
हाँ, विश्वनाथ मंदिर इस तरफ है,
विश्वनाथ मंदिर इस साइड है, ये आपकी मस्जिद है।
हाँ,
और इसके इधर क्या है?
इधर ये सामने कॉरिडोर वाला वो बना रहे हैं, ब्यास जी का मकान वगैरह था, वो सब टुकड़ा ताड़ा है इन्होंने।
अच्छा, ये गंगा के साइड।
देखिए कब कौन सी घटना घट जाए नहीं मालूम। अभी 2 तारीख की जो घटना है वो मामूली घटना नहीं थी, छोटी मोटी।
पहले चारों तरफ से खाली कर दिया गया था वहाँ भी, बाबरी मस्जिद के पास भी, और वैसा ही यहाँ पे भी मंजर है।
ये इस तरीके की खौफ पैदा करने की तो कोशिश की जा रही है काफ़ी दिनों से।
स्थिति बहुत ख़राब हम लोगों को, जैसे क्षेत्र से बाहर निकलते हुए थोड़ा सा वो होता है, डर लगता है।
क्या मोदी जी जब अपना सपनों का ड्रीम यहाँ उतार रहे थे, 300 लोगों का घर गिरा रहे थे, तो उन्हें ये नहीं कहना चाहिए था कि मैं चाहता हूँ कि यहाँ मंदिर और मस्जिद एक साथ रहें?
प्रशासनिक ये जो वहाँ पे कॉरिडोर बनाने के लिए जो मकानात तोड़े जा रहे थे, उसी दौरान वो हमारी बाउंड्री वॉल थी उसको तोड़ा गया, और उसके बाद जो विवाद हुआ
सामने देखते हुए कि मस्जिद की दीवारें हैं, तो उनको इस चीज को तोड़वाने की क्या जरूरत थी? प्रशासन तो देख रही है, इतना ड्यूटी जो लगा हुआ प्रशासन का किस लिए? इसीलिए ना कि ना मस्जिद पे कोई बात हो ना मंदिर पे कोई बात।
क्या लगता है कौन तोड़वा रहा है?
कौन तोड़वा रहा है? अधिकारी का मिले हुए भगत है।
कौन कौन
कौन कौन? अरे सारे अधिकारी मोदी के जितने दामाद हैं सब लोग।
पोलराइजेशन का एजेंडा लेकर के, हिंदू राष्ट्र का एजेंडा लेकर के आप ज्ञानवापी मस्जिद के साथ भी वही हश्र नहीं करेंगे बाबरी मस्जिद का जो किया, इसकी क्या गारंटी है?
जो स्थिति यहाँ पर बाबरी मस्जिद के गिरने के बाद हुई थी, लगातार दंगे का महीना होता था, हर साल में 2 महीना दंगा में जाता था, सारा व्यवसाय यहाँ का चौपट हो गया था। आप देख लीजिए अयोध्या जाकर कि उसका क्या परिणाम है, आज तक अयोध्या विस्तृत रूप से पनप नहीं पाया है।
वी नाउ मूव टू साइक्लोन फोनी, द स्ट्रॉन्गेस्ट लैंडफॉलिंग ट्रॉपिकल साइक्लोन टू हिट इंडिया इन नियरली 5 years. This cyclone is expected to make landfall in Odisha on Friday. Media reports indicate that at least 8 lakh people are in the process of being evacuated. Cyclone Phoni has become an extremely severe cyclonic storm, and wind speeds are expected to touch 200 km per hour on landfall. The Coast Guard and Navy have deployed ships and helicopters for relief and rescue operations. Army and Air Force units have also been put on standby in Odisha, West Bengal and Andhra Pradesh. Some 900 cyclone shelters have been set up across the state of Odisha to house evacuees, and a holiday has been declared for schools. Last year, over 60 people died when Cyclone Titli, which was less severe than Foni, hit the states of Odisha and Andhra Pradesh. We now move on to international news, and we have with us Prabir. Prabir, the first story we're looking at is about the jail term to Julian Assange. So as we know, Assange was sentenced yesterday to 50 weeks in jail for the very minor offense of jumping bail. So how do you see this particular harsh sentencing in the context of the extradition hearing that's also coming up?
Well, the first issue is that Julian Assange had from the beginning said that he was not jumping bail because he didn't want to face the Swedish charges, which were of rape under Swedish law, a lot of controversy in the nature of the charges on the law. Leaving that aside, he said his main issue was that Sweden did not give an undertaking. They would not extradite him to the United States, and he knew or he anticipated that there was a grand jury indictment waiting to be heard. The minute he would come, he would be arrested, there would be extradition request moved with the grand jury indictment being immediately processed. Now, this is exactly what has happened. Exactly. He's been arrested, the grand jury indictment has taken place, and he's been charged with what could amount to activities which are equivalent to spying. Mm-hmm. And we have again earlier discussed in News Click how this whole attempt to convict him of spying, a conspiracy, etc., etc., are extremely dangerous for the press. Right. But he has proved that the extradition request was in the making if he was ever arrested, and that was the real reason for his not acceding to the UK order for arrest.
Right.
Now, in this case, we must also see that the UK court has been extremely harsh.
Exactly.
They made a huge number of comments on him, which are completely uncalled for, which didn't have any basis.
Right.
And then they've given him a sentence. The longest sentence for jumping bail is 52 weeks, 1 year. In this case, this is 50 weeks, nearly the maximum they could keep him in. So even if the extradition request fails, he's going to be in for a year.
Right.
But the question is how much the judicial process in the UK is going to be fair to Julian, itself an open question, given the fact what we have seen of the judiciary now and the way they have dealt with the bail petition. So I think we have a lot of issues which we have to really face up to vis-a-vis Julian Assange's extradition request. But it's also equally true that we have to look at how serious the judicial impartiality is going to be maintained in this particular case.
And moving on to the question of Masood Azhar, who's been declared a global terrorist. Now, in the Indian establishment is celebrating this is a major victory for India, as all the countries of the world, big and small, have united on this. But is this actually as much of a victory or as they're portraying, and what probably has India to give up for this?
Well, let's look at what is the nature of the victory and the fact that earlier we had Hafiz Saeed and Dawood Ibrahim, two equally big, if not bigger names, also designated as terrorists, don't seem to have suffered too much on that count. Of course, we know that Pakistan has sheltered terrorist organizations and has used terror networks as a part of its, shall we say, external policy. That's been something that they have always done. Let's also not look at the United States and UK and others being essentially extremely pure on that count. In fact, they are the ones who have also promoted Masood Azhar and all these elements in their various political campaigns earlier in Afghanistan and later also in West Asia. So these are people that we know will have played ball with terrorists earlier. So the question is, these are the same people we have gone to, Saudis, United States and so on, to help with this, with declaring him a terrorist. But as we have said earlier, how much does it help us is something that we have to see. You know, ultimately, terrorism on the ground, particularly in Kashmir, where the Pulwama blast took place, has to be resolved by Indian security establishment and Indian political establishment squarely facing the problem of alienation of the people. And if the alienation of the people continues, then of course it will spawn more and more, you know, terrorist groups.
Right.
condemning one or the other as terrorists is not going to solve that problem, as we are seeing now in Kashmir. The last point, there is an irony in this particular case. You know, the irony is the one who led the quiet diplomacy in United Nations is Syed Akbaruddin, our representative of United Nations. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure, as Ambassador Bhadra Kumar has said in his speech today in NewsClick, that a lot of the people, Adityanath, Amit Shah and Modi, would not be happy that Masood Azhar had to be brought to book in this sense in the United Nations by Syed Akbaruddin.
Also, Prabir, in exchange or in return for this declaration, will India have to give up something as far as importing oil from Iran is concerned?
Well, Trump has already indicated that they are helping us with the Masood Azhar case, mm-hmm. and therefore he expects India to fall in line on the Iran issue and not import oil from Iran. Now that would, as you have discussed with Ambassador Talmiz earlier, would mean about a 2,500 to 3,000 crore hit that India will take for what could be argued is a pyrrhic victory of getting Azhar declared as a terrorist. So hard cash for something which could or may not have much implications in real terms.
Thank you, Prabir. That's all we have time for today. To follow these stories in detail, check our website newsclick.in and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thanks for watching.